Belinda Audio presents this unabridged recording of Outback Heart, written and read by Joanne van Os.
I have dedicated this book to my sons, Callum and Sean. One of the colourful characteristics of the Northern Territory is its language, and an explanation of some of the more unfamiliar words and phrases follows. The story begins at the next track. Barrage. A barrier constructed across a river to prevent or impede the flow of saltwater upstream. Saltwater intrusion is a major issue in the Mary River system. Several barrages were constructed, including a major one at Shady Camp which vehicles could drive across. Barramundi, or barra, popular game fish in northern Australia and great eating. Baduri oven, a rolled steel baking dish with a fitted lid that comes halfway down the sides of the dish, used for cooking in coals, also called a duri. Billy, a metal tin used for boiling water. Tea leaves are added to it to make tea. Bogey, a bath or a wash. Breakaways, animals which break away from the mob. Brownie, a solid kind of cake, flavoured with ginger and currants, cooked in a camp oven. BTEC, bovine tuberculosis eradication campaign. Bull catcher, a cut-down, highly modified four-wheel drive vehicle used for catching cattle bulls and buffalo, or the driver of a bull catcher. Camp oven, often known as a Dutch oven, a cast-iron baking dish with a well-fitted lid. Coaches, a quiet mob of cattle taken out on a muster, into which the new, fresh cattle are run. Damper, a solid kind of bread made from flour, risings, salt and water. Donga, a rough house or shelter. Drover, a person taking cattle or sheep overland, usually long distances. Esky, an insulated icebox for carrying cold food and drinks. Fire unit, a portable water pump used for firefighting as well as spraying weeds. Flash, smart or fancy. Flogging, a beating or to beat someone at a game. Genset, an engine which generates electricity. Hot water donkey, a bush hot water system made from a 44-gallon drum. Jump up, a rough access up a steep escarpment. Killer, a cattle beast or buffalo butchered for meat. You get a killer. Long drop, an outside toilet, which is a deep hole in the ground with or without a toilet bowl fixed over it. Mickey bull, a young cattle bull. Muster, the action of gathering cattle or sheep together, called a roundup in the US. Pandanus, a type of screw palm common in the north of Australia. It has long narrow leaves with small thorns along the edges and grows in a spiral fashion. Pannikin, an enamelled metal cup. Punker, a large swinging fan fixed to the ceiling. Modern versions are electrically operated, but in 19th century India, they were moved by the punka walla who pulled a rope. Rushing, when a mob of cattle suddenly gallop off together, called stampeding in the US. Scrub bull, an unbranded wild cattle bull. Smoko, morning tea. Station, a large pastoral property running cattle or sheep, a ranch in the US. Stock camp, a group of stockmen, or ringers, who go out on horseback mustering cattle, staying out for weeks or months at a time, and sleeping in swags on the ground. Swag, a bedroll, a canvas ground sheet that encloses a thin mattress, sheets and blankets, is rolled up and tied with, usually, leather straps. Tail out. To walk mustered stock out and keep them quiet, usually on horseback. To be cactus. To be finished, ruined, or even dead. He's cactus means he's dead. Ute, short for utility vehicle. VJY, the outpost radio network based in Darwin. It was the public communication system for remote regions in the Top End and operated by Telecom Australia. Yabbies, a type of freshwater crayfish. The epigraph reads, "Some people hear the howl of the wolf at night and understand its voice. They are unable to stay in the safe places of the world and seek out its soul in spite of how dangerous that can be. Sometimes that search is for the wild and remote places of the world. Sometimes it is for the wild and remote places of the human spirit. Perhaps an even more dangerous journey." Prologue, 3rd of August, 1999. The two policemen had been on duty since 3:30 a.m. There had been no sign of the madman who had been shooting up houses in the area a few hours earlier. Now it was past 9 a.m. and the sun was doing its best work. The heat haze was already warping the view north up the highway to Darwin. White striped bitumen, khaki olive bush and red dirt shimmered and wavered into the distance. South of the roadblock, a long line of road trains, cars and caravans grew impatient and irritated as they slowly roasted in the relentless heat. Sergeant Glenn Hewitson and his partner, Constable Jamie O'Brien, had been roused from their beds in Adelaide River in the dead of night after shots had been fired at residents in the Darwin rural area, about 60 kilometres south of Darwin. They were ordered to set up a roadblock at the intersection of the Stuart Highway and Old Bino Road, less than a kilometre from the northern roadblock at Kentish Road, stopping all traffic from moving through the area. The tactical response group had been searching most of the night without any result, and it now seemed unlikely that the gunman would still be hanging around in broad daylight. A couple of locals, waiting to get to work, wandered over to chat with the officers. Jonathan Anthony's leant against the bonnet of the squad car, and Anthony Hobden squatted nearby, talking to the officers. It had been a long night, but now in broad daylight, it seemed like there wasn't much to worry about. The first shot spun Anthony's off the bonnet and onto the ground. The policemen snatched up their weapons and returned fire, just before the gunman's second shot tore through a gap in Hewitson's ballistic vest and dropped him to the road. O'Brien kept up a hail of shots in the direction of the armed man, who he could just make out across the road. The TRG squad ran for their vehicles as soon as they heard the gunfire. The two vehicles swerved to stop a few hundred metres away from the roadblock, and one clipped the other and rolled. The crash attracted the gunman's attention, and he rose up onto one knee from his position in the grass and swung his rifle around at the men scrambling from the rear of the wrecked troop carrier. Constable O'Brien suddenly had a clear shot and took it, and the gunman fell. It was the end of several things. It was the end of the life of a fine young policeman, a man with a young family who was loved and respected in the small community of Adelaide River, where he lived and worked. It was the end of the Crocodile Dundee story, according to the media. And it was the end of Rod Ansell, also a man with a family who loved him and who had once been a national hero, a reflection of what Australia liked most about itself. Now he lay dead on the side of a road in the outback, his face in the dirt, his blood seeping into the hot ground, his body torn and blasted with shotgun pellets. This is the story of my life with Rod Ansell, who had first captured the imagination of Australians when he survived for 2 months in 1977 on a remote river in the far north. Our relationship spanned 22 years, first as lovers, then spouses, parents, business partners, and finally as divorcees. How does someone go from being a person whose extraordinary story of survival in the wild inspired so many people to a psychotic, drug-crazed gunman who shot four people, killing one of them, a police officer, before being killed himself? It was the question asked by a lot of people when Rod died, and I'm attempting to answer it here, or at least to shed some reasonable light on it. It may help people understand what happened to a man who could have been anything and who had so much to offer, but who got lost along the way. Maybe he was a captive of his dreams and fantasies. Maybe he had some fatal flaw that no one could see or circumvent. He took a young girl from the suburbs of Melbourne to the outreaches of her existence and made her life the most exhilarating, terrifying, and awesome experience in his own quest to find out what life was all about. What he didn't understand and didn't learn was that you don't have to destroy life or the people you love to find that out. This is a story of love and how the people we love can have devastating effects on us that bear little resemblance to the effects of love. It's a story about survival in more ways than one. Chapter 1, My Father's Genes. Mum blames it on the family loo. When people ask her why her eldest daughter lives so far away, she points to the toilet. She hung a huge map of Australia in there one day with the throwaway line that while we're attending to business, we may as well learn some geography. I used to study that map, and in particular the far north coast. There were no roads, but there were little towns, miles and miles of apparently nothing. How did people live in that part of the world? The first chance I got, I was going to go and find out. My father, Martin van Os, had emigrated from Holland in 1952 on board one of the Liberty ships, the Waterman. Third youngest of nine children, he was born in 1929 in Fekkel, a small village in the south of Holland, where he spent his adolescent years under German occupation during World War II. He hated the cold, the snow, and the dampness of his home country, and often told people that as soon as he was old enough, he was going somewhere warm. The Dutch army thoughtfully sent him to do his national service in the hot latitudes of the West Indies, where he thrived in the heat and the strangeness of islands filled with donkeys and cactus. He had a way with words and filled in any spare time there, writing letters and love poems for his fellow soldiers to send back to their sweethearts. His older sister Anne had married and immigrated to Australia, so the choice of where to go after he left the army was simple. Australia was booming in the 50s and there was plenty of work for a qualified carpenter, and it was definitely warm. His brother-in-law met him when he landed in Melbourne in November 1952, and Martin stepped off the ship and onto the back of a motorbike to ride to Eildon Weir, where a job was waiting for him. The following year, he went to work at Kwinana in Western Australia, returning to Melbourne to spend Christmas with his sister's family. In January 1954, Martin boarded the Strathaden at Port Melbourne to sail back to Perth. Coming out of his cabin the first night on board, he bumped into a young lady with the most beautiful smile. Therese O'Sullivan had joined the ship in Sydney and was also bound for Western Australia, where she was going to work as a governess for her sister Peg Pennington on her sheep station. Just two nights later, Martin asked Therese to marry him. After a courtship conducted for several months over country phone lines, with the neighbours listening in and offering advice, they returned to Therese's family home in Sydney, where they were married in December 1954. Therese had grown up in a noisy, busy household, the ninth of 12 children. The youngest of six girls, in the middle of her six brothers, she was born at the Nepean Dam west of Wollongong in New South Wales in 1931, where her father, Thomas O'Sullivan, was working. The family moved to Sydney not long afterwards, and in 1944 Thomas died, leaving my grandmother to raise a large family on her own, with nearly half of them still at school. It was a year for tragedy because her eldest son, also named Thomas, was killed fighting in New Guinea just 7 months later. For the last 3.5 years of the war, her daughter Catherine, who was a nun in New Guinea, had been held in a prisoner of war camp by the Japanese with the rest of her convent. The nuns had refused to leave when the war came to their part of the world, instead staying in Rabaul to nurse the Allied wounded. My grandmother, May O'Sullivan, was made of some pretty tough stuff. In spite of everything, she managed to keep her family together under extremely difficult circumstances and lived to see most of her 47 grandchildren before she died at the age of 75. By 1958, my parents had three children. I was born in October 1955, Peter in 1957, and Robert 1 year to the day later in 1958. We had lived with my grandmother and her three youngest sons so far, which helped my parents get on their feet, but there was more work for a carpenter in Melbourne, and land was cheaper there than it was in Sydney. And it must have been getting a bit cosy with all of us under one roof, even though it was a big house. Mum must have missed her family terribly when we moved to Melbourne. However, with three children by the time I was 27 months old, she probably didn't have a lot of space to think about it. Two more daughters followed, Leonie in 1960 and Pauline in 1966. Our new neighbourhood had a lot of young families, and Mum soon got to know the other mothers in the street, most of whom have remained friends for the last 45 years. It was a great network of women who supported each other through various crises, celebrated every happy event, looked after each other's children, and of course provided me and my siblings with a whole lot of playmates. Ringwood was 26 kilometres from the city and the outer limit of eastern suburbia at the time. Maidstone Street was just a dirt road, and the countryside surrounding us was a combination of paddocks and uncleared bush, paradise for energetic kids. Our childhood was typical of suburban Australia in the early 60s. Every house in our street seemed to be full of kids. We roamed the bush with them and played in each other's backyards. Dad built us amazing cubby houses, which he kept improving as the years went on, and constructed all kinds of playground equipment in our backyard. Looking at the safety-conscious designs of today, Dad's were a litigation looking for a courtroom, but every kid in the street thought we were the luckiest in the world. The merry-go-round was a smooth-barked log mounted on a centre pivot, with a seat at each end. The centre point greased well so it spun as fast as we could push it. A large and heavy wooden rocker could hold six or eight kids and be rocked to within a gasp of disaster. And look out if your toes got in the way. We had ropes hanging out of trees to swing on, parallel bars nailed up between them, which someone would regularly fall off while hanging upside down, swings and a big heavy seesaw. There were bumps and scrapes, but no one ever seriously hurt themselves. Building billy carts was a major obsession. Peter, Robbie and I messed around with apple crates and pram wheels, but Dad's billy carts were the envy of the neighbourhood. One in particular was an ancient push-pull, chain-driven affair, which Dad modified and rebuilt until it looked like Fred Flintstone's car. The hill in our street was steep enough to get up some speed, and once this billy cart got going, there was no steering it, let alone stopping. Dad was a wizard with anything timber, but mechanics were not really his field. There were no brakes, apart from a length of wood he fixed to the back, with the instruction to push it back as hard as you could so it dug in the ground and slowed you down. We worked out pretty soon that this was the quickest way to capsize the cart. Permanently scabbed knees and elbows were just a normal part of life. Dad had come to Australia looking for the outback and better weather. Melbourne certainly wasn't the outback, but at least the weather was warmer than Holland. He made up for the tameness of the suburbs by taking us kids into the bush, anywhere he couldn't see houses and telegraph poles, at every opportunity. He'd walk the legs off us, exclaiming all the way about the smells and the sounds of water far off and hidden lyrebirds, singing songs at the top of his lungs and somehow never losing any of us. When I was 11, we bought our first car and began going on camping holidays for 3 weeks every Christmas. Two or three other families usually came with us, which meant that there were around 15 children to entertain each other. Mum loved the beach, so we mostly headed for the coast or somewhere with water. 3 weeks with five children in a tent, it was no mean feat for my city-raised mother, and being Victoria, that sometimes meant five children in a wet tent. We were all given our jobs, and once breakfast and clothes washing were finished, Mum would head for the beach with an umbrella and a stack of books. It was the only time of the year when she really could relax. We grew up surrounded by a wonderful multicultural blend of people. The huge wave of immigration to Australia after the war meant that my classmates right through school were a mix of Italian, Polish, Latvian, Dutch, British, Irish, Hungarian and Yugoslav migrants. I never heard anyone called a wog or a dago at school.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.